I'm sitting in my studio, and I have a couple of pictures of the SS United States. I've had a model for a long time that I'd never made, but I had, and also this painting that you see on the menu and stuff like that. Well, I had a copy of it, and I looked at the ship, and I thought that ship is the culmination, I will bet, of all kinds of inventions. At the age of 10, my mother and brother and sister and I took the ship from Southampton in England to come to the United States. So I have a direct connection with it. And I wasn't sure what that meant, except that I had a connection with it. And I'm aware of this. I don't really know it, because as a 10-year-old in tourist class, you don't get to know it. You just hang out on it for 5 days, and then you get off. But it was enough of a link. And the autobiographical part of the story, my part of the story, is a small part, but in terms of the pages in the book, but maybe it's a big part in terms of actually choosing it in the first place. But it's the ship's story. It's my story a little bit, but it's also William Francis Gibbs's story, the man whose vision it was to spend the rest of his life somehow involved with ships. I only wanted to see, as a 10-year-old, the Empire State Building. That was my whole reason for, you know, besides the fact that my parents said, get on the ship, was coming to the U.S., was actually to see the building, because I had a picture of it in one of my books, and I couldn't believe its size. It never occurred to me that I was on something of approximately the same size, and that was equally significant in its own way. We came from a kind of dark, industrial, northern English town to, you know, the brilliant color of fall in New Jersey, northern New Jersey. And, you know, it seemed like, wow, that was magical. One of the things that's been difficult about the ship story has been the fact that the ship is still with us. It's still, you know, docked in Philadelphia, and there has been this ongoing battle to save it. I have felt a little bit under pressure, because who knows whether it will be saved. I mean, it's a beautiful object filled with empty space that could be used for almost anything. And for me, the important thing about it is just this object. It takes us back to another time. I mean, to a time when you saw huge things being shaped and sculpted in a way that would allude to their speed, their prestige in a sense. I mean, this ship was designed to be sort of the flagship of the United States post-war. Things are looking good for the United States, and it was time perhaps to have a flagship. And this is a beauty. But being able to go and see it again as an adult after having traveled on it for those 5 days was such a gift. And I think it might have been part of my motivation for even pursuing it before I fully knew what I was getting into. This was my excuse to get on that ship, to make the arrangement. It's a thrill to experience that, and wonderful to now know what was down below, what made it all possible, the things that never even occurred to me. I didn't know anything about the ship, which is pretty incredible. I mean, on this thing for 5 days, and all I wanted to see was the Empire State Building. I had no idea what this thing was that we were on. I had no idea that it was the fastest ship ever built, that it could cross the Atlantic in 3.5 days. I wasn't really encouraged to find out more about it, because in tourist class, you don't really have the run of the ship. We did nothing on the ship. I mean, I went to the movies every day, 3 times, same movies. And then just, you know, hanging out on deck, passing time.
This is the legendary movie theater in which I spent most of 4 days as we traveled across the Atlantic, because there was not a lot for a 10-year-old kid to do. This was totally safe. This was September of 1957, and they were first-run features. I mean, this notion of building this connection with Hollywood to attract Hollywood passengers and so on, to become the ship used by the movie stars, that was all part of it. Tourist class, knowing that we would take our lives or try to take over the ship, out of sheer boredom after 2 days, decided it was worth dedicating a movie theater just to tourist class passengers, especially the young ones. So this was home.
Had we been first class passengers, which we were not, it would have been maybe a different thing, a different experience. And you can, you sit with the captain, and I wouldn't, but my mother would have, perhaps. been invited to the captain's table, were we first class passengers? And she, although she wouldn't, could have asked questions about technically and so on and so forth, which could have been quite interesting. But anyway, that was never an option. I spent a lot of time on deck looking at the horizon, wishing it would just go away, and I waiting to see the Empire State Building come into view.
So I would come out here, and I would just stand here, and I would be waiting to see it pop up over the horizon. And, it never did. Not even until... I didn't really see it until we were on the Hudson River. This was merely the means of getting me from England to New York, the home of the Empire State Building.
Were you disappointed when you finally saw it?
Totally. That's okay.
Gradually, life settled into a pattern of new routines and occasional surprises. My walk to school took me over a railroad crossing, and on one particularly clear day, I saw in the distance the unmistakable silhouette of the Empire State Building. Then, one night, as I walked home from Boy Scouts across those same tracks, I noticed a flashing light and realized it must be coming from the top of the building. Any lingering disappointment about our first encounter instantly vanished, and in its place came a reassuring feeling I can still remember over 60 years later. The tallest building in the world, having lured me across the Atlantic Ocean under false pretenses, was keeping an eye on me day and night as this foreign land became home. So when I decided to finally tackle this project, I was learning about it for the very first time. There was a lot to learn, but I didn't even know what the questions were. I didn't even know that I could be interested in that, which is a little unusual because I love trains. I would hang out by the railway track, anywhere near a railway track, and I would be hanging out there, just watch those things come through. So impressive, so massive. And in a way, somewhat self-explanatory. I mean, you know that steam coming out from the wheels and the smoke coming out from the stack is all about providing the power, generating the power that makes this thing go back and forth, that turns the wheels, and you can see it. With the ship, it's all hidden. So it's not like you could even, as a tourist class passenger, walk past the engine room one day and look through the glass windows. There were no glass windows. I mean, this is a military and slash private vessel in which, things that drove it and, made its design develop the way it did were often secret. And Gibbs wanted it all to be secret. So that's the other thing, Gibbs. I didn't know about the ship. I certainly didn't know about this guy, William Francis Gibbs.
So there were chairs in here?
Deck chairs.
And the little things where they would keep the tea or coffee or whatever
right,
so it was.
Bouillon.
Every once in a while. Mm-hmm.
So my grandfather was born and raised here in Philadelphia. And when he was a boy, he was taken by his father and accompanied by some of his other siblings to the launch of a great American ship at Cramp Yard, just down the river from here, the St. Louis. And it was an extraordinary experience for him to see this huge American liner launched with all of the fanfare, with the crowds of people. And he later said that at that point in time, he dedicated his life to ships and never looked back. So that was his initial moment.
He had sketched up this notion of designing the biggest, the longest, and fastest passenger liner in the world back in the, when he was 28, 29. And because he and his brother Frederick had done their homework, and they had some connections, he got J.P. Morgan Jr.'s backing to take on this project, and they were set up. But it was the wrong time with the war and the danger of U-boats and things of that nature. So he wasn't able to do it, but he didn't just give up. he kept learning with every opportunity and did a lot of ships along the way. Never gave up.
And he was just very strategic. His political capital was so high after the war because of the extraordinary input of his firm, and they played such a major role in World War II that it was the moment at long last to come in and get it done. And so, yes, he says that just all of the innovations that were perfected during the course of the war were packed into this hull.
Well, we can tell from personal experience today that the air conditioning would have been great. I don't know why it's off now, but it's hot in here. It's a metal box, and you're spending a lot of time inside the ship as it moves across the North Atlantic, because you're not always going to get great weather.
And air conditioning was one of many kind of modern elements. I mean, the ship was all about innovation, modernity. So it also was where microwave ovens were first brought online, the dimmer switch. I mean, that was part of its branding and part of what it embodied. This was just all the cutting edge technology put to great purpose.
Literally, the bells and whistles were top of the line, as was the basic, the fundamental design and construction of the ship. It had it all. So this is the wheel room, the wheelhouse. What's really interesting is you get a size of the ship, but this is the part of the ship from which it was all controlled. This is the port rear engine in the rear engine room. This is the forward engine room, port side. Same on the other side, the two matching for the starboard side. This is the compass. These are the two wheels. One of these was a kind of autopilot. You could just switch it on, and the other one was operated, obviously, by hand. And these two, one here and one on the other side of the chart table, were for the radar, connected to the radar mast. And it's all here. This is, you could run the ship and chart the whole course, and incredibly efficient. Ship is maiden voyage in 1952. By 68, it's over. So talk about luck, in a way. But he wasn't thinking about luck, and he wasn't too worried about the airplanes that were sort of buzzing overhead. But the federal government was willing to support it because this would be a fantastic troop-carrying ship, just in case we should have problems on the Korean Peninsula. I mean, this is a ship that's designed to go through the Panama Canal with 14,000 soldiers on it, and then zip across the Pacific and get people where they need to go. An airplane's not going to do that. Many, many airplanes and so on and so forth. So I guess that still seemed like a logical thing. But he was still able to hang his dream of this commercial vessel onto the military requirements and weave them together. So you have a ship that's very efficient and streamlined, but streamlined more, either for speed or inside to minimize excess of any kind. He was totally against, the sort of big, thick, comfortable furniture of the Queen Mary and the Queen Elizabeth and velvet drapes and whatever else. This was a ship of the late 40s, early 50s, and very much of its time. And it's an icon of a period in time, but it's also, reminiscent of, in a way, one man's vision and how you don't let go, you hold on to it. So it's his persistence, it's that ability to just sort of stay with it. And if I whine after like 3 or 4 years or 5 years on a book, I can no longer really allow that. I can no longer excuse that, because I think about William Francis. If he'd stopped after 4 years and said, "This is too hard," we wouldn't have that ship. We wouldn't have that extraordinary piece of machinery.